Okay, so hi, I'm Yoav Glazner. We're going to talk about a scoop of Python scopes. I'm going to take a short intro for this talk. Like, after this talk, your life will split into two, before the army and after the army, and it won't be the same. So I'm developing Python for like over 10 years. I'm a developer at Common Sense Robotics. We use Python to move robots around. I'm going to show a bit like some robots moving. So we have actually like, okay, so it's actually, okay. So we actually have Python that runs all those robots. We can even see a few bugs here and there and it really works. So that's about us. In this talk, we're gonna talk about like the insides of the CPython interpreter, especially CPython, not the other implementations, but we're gonna mention them a bit. And we're gonna, unfortunately, we won't have much touch to the robots, so this is the last slide that we'll see them. So, okay, let's move on. So, I got the last session. don't have anything more to say about it, that's it. Okay, so the agenda for today, we're going to talk about the Python scopes, the legib rule. We're going to dis some stuff, like disassemble the bytecode of CPython and understand things. And then we're going to have the third phase of the enlightenment, and we're going to understand things, and I don't know. So, okay, so let's start. We have four scopes in Python. We have the local scope, the enclosed scope, the global scope, and the built-in scope. So the local scope is each function has its own local variables. The enclosed scope is a function that rests inside another function and can view the enclosing scope of it. So it can view the variables that are defined in the functions above it. The global scope is just the module scope, a dictionary that isn't on the module and you have access from in the module itself and you can import from it and et cetera, et cetera. And the built-in module, which is like an invisible scope that things are just there. This is just a slide, this is not like a real crash or something. So the legib rule means that this is the order that Python looks up variables. It looks first in the local scope in the same function, then in enclosed function, the enclosed scope, then in the same module that the function was defined in, and last in the built-in mode, in the built-in scope. So this is the legib rule or LEGB. This is a more graphical way to view it, like zooming out. Blah, blah, blah. So a bit of implementation detail. So the local scope in Python is implemented as an array of pointers to Python objects. When the Python compiles a code, it knows which variables are local, and in runtime just uses indexes in this array to access them. This is in the local scope. The enclosed scope is a bit more tricky. You have like an array of cells. And the reason you have these cells is when you need a pointer in direction, because you can view an object that is defined in the outer scope of view, and you want the ability to see changes. So you need like a pointer to a cell that holds a pointer to some value that can change. So you have a level of indirection, but performance-wise, it's like almost the same as local. It's just like implementation detail to enable this ability to view changes, because the local scope can be array because only the function can change it. The enclosed scope can be changed by both places. The global model scope is just a normal dictionary. I'm saying normal, it's not really normal. It has a bit of different heuristics and hash collision changes like the dictionary size, but basically it's a Python dict. The built-in module is also, it's also a dict, eventually. It's a special dict that CPython implemented in C, but it's actually another dict, so it's very easy to understand. Simple example of the local scope, you have variables, you have arguments for the functions that are also local, and that's pretty trivial, I guess. In closed scope, you have a full function that defines a bar function. The bar can access the A variable and B variable that are defined in the enclosed scope. So some people call these variables non-closed variables, but it's really confusing, so I won't use this term a lot. The global scope, even more easy to understand, I guess. You have all things that are defined in the module, the functions, the variables, and can be accessed from anywhere in the same module, of course. Okay, and the last, the built-in scope, the len function, the any, the all, the bytes, the str, all the functions that we use, and like they are not anywhere, they are there, they are in the built-in module, the built-in scope. You can even access it. It's like, it behaves like a module. You, like, you can put underscore built-ins, dunder built-ins, and access it. It's a module. It has a dict. You can iterate it and print it, and you get all the a very lengthy list. We don't use most of them all the time, but we have it. We can even see the breakpoint. It's quite new. It's from, I think, two versions earlier in Python, Python 3.6 or 3.5. Yeah. Okay. So now the second part of the talk, we're going to talk about the this module. I know a few talks before me talked about this show bytecode, so it will be more easy, I guess, for me. So we really, everybody can use this module. Like, it's super easy to use and even understand, because Python bytecode is really simple. It's not like not complex at all. So if you have like this, this is how you use it. You have a function and you just pass it to the this module. You have, the this has a this function and you use it. This is the output of the foo method. It just loads none and returns it because it doesn't do anything. Okay. So let's disassemble the previous examples and see if we can understand a bit more into the details. So we're returning to the local scope. Remember, this is the function from then. We use the this module, and we see that to load A and B, we have the byte instruction load fast. And load fast actually means go to the local array and just take it by index. Like, A is actually 0, B is 1, and they're not actually 0 and 1 actually in the bytecode, but the index is known. And then you can manipulate it, and et cetera, et cetera. The enclosed scope is a bit more tricky, as we explained before, but let's try to look at the bytecode. So when the bar function is created, we do like a load, we are creating closure for it. And the closure holds the pointers to the cells that it's going to need. So you can see A and B in the load closure. And you can see like the make function, and the store fast is about like storing the bar itself. Like, it's not a variable like A and B, it's the variable itself, the function that we define. And inside bar, you can see the load deref and the load deref instruction, which means don't go to the local array, go to the cells that are in your closures and look there for the variables. And that's how it looks in bytecode. Global, this bytecode is like, okay, so here function foo takes looks at A from the global scope, and wow, yes, load global, not so futuristic. So as you can see, already in the compilation phase of Python, the scope resolution order is defined. It's not like the interpreter looks, oh, I will look in the global scope, or the local scope, and then close it, and then global. No, already in the compilation time, it knows what to look for. And this is a bit more fast than just go iterating. And that said, we get to the built-in. So we have the len method that we're gonna use from the built-in. It's not in the global scope. And whoops, we see the same instruction again, load global. So, okay, this is weird. Like, we said that it's gonna look in the global scope, right? In the module. So yes, it's gonna look in the module. It won't find it there. And then it will look in the built-in scope. So we have a double lookup. And maybe many people talk about it, and there are tricks to avoid it, and the PyPI has a JIT that puts guards on it and make it more fast just for this case. But actually, this is, you can actually see it in the bytecode. It's the same bytecode, and this is the reason we have a double lookup for the built-in. And it's a bit annoying, right? So that's it. That's what we have. But maybe we're gonna rethink it in the following minutes. So we got to the third part. We're going to dive a bit deeper and see what we understand by looking at the bytecode. So we know this example, like you take the len and you put it inside the default argument, and then when you use it, you have a local lookup, and it's much more faster than lookup in do two lookups in a dictionary. Here you just have an index in a local array, and you just find it, and it's fast. And as I mentioned before, PyPI doesn't need it because it has a JIT. And it's a bit, it's a bit a shame to see code like this, right? It's annoying. Most of the time people put it and they don't really need it. It's not really a performance issue either. So like, I thought like, okay, let's take the globals and just put all the built-ins inside, and then we have one lookup and everything will be fine again. So don't try this, yes? Okay, so you can try this. But why should we stop here, right? Like, okay, so let's do it for all the models we imported so far. And then, like, why ever anybody thought about this before? Look, it's awesome. We have one lookup. So, of course, I'm lying. Like, I'm making every global, every dictionary of a model much more bigger, and the lookup will be slower. Yada yada, cache size, and all that. So, but it's interesting to see that we can do it. Like, we can avoid the double lookup, but in trade-off of a slower model dictionary. So, we have that. We have the locals function that returns us the local scope as a dictionary. Now, I just said before that it's not a dictionary. So what it does under the hood, it just builds one. It's, they look at the array, move one by one, and builds a dictionary. So this function is a bit costly if the scope is big. And there are side effects to it. You can't mutate it. If you mutate the local scope that you got, it's not really the local scope, just a copy of it. So it doesn't work, and we know why. We know that the bytecode won't look there. So it's just a copy. And we do know why the global scope, the globals function work. It just returns a pointer to the same, to the model dictionary. So you change the dictionary, you change the model scope. It's the same. Okay, and close scope. So we're returning to this. Now we're going to talk about the non-local keyword. So it was added in Python 3 something. And it actually, it lets us the ability to change the out of scope. It wasn't really there. They did some hack. You could have used global, but it didn't always did the right behavior in previous versions. Like, and the non-local really explicitly says, I want a scope that is one or more above me. So actually it's one above me, it can't be two above me. So if we look at the bytecode, so we see the store deref. We don't see store fast as in we see in the variable A. We see store deref as in B, because we need to go to the cells and update the pointer there so the function foo can view it. I'll just show the function foo again. Yeah? So we also want the function foo to know that we changed. So this is why we have the pointer in direction in the cells and have two ways to define almost the same thing in the locals and the non-closed variables. This is a classical error that we get in Python. We get the unbound local error. We also know why we get this now, because the Python compiler compiled A as a local. He saw that we are assigning it here. So every bytecode that has in the function foo does load fast and use the local store, and it's just not there, so we can't compile it. So so we had the global in this case, and then in compile time we'll get the load global instruction and the set global and the store global instruction. So this will work, and we know that it works in the compile time of Python, because now we understand, like, the resolution, most of the resolution happens in compile time. That's maybe the major take we see here. Some magic. So we talked about that the built-in is just a dict, so we can just add things there. Like, we can add the magic, and we have cheese everywhere, and everybody is happy. Not really that usable, and like, I'm pretty glad that the Python community doesn't do that a lot, or at all, I think. But you can do some pranks to your friends, so you can switch any and all. And well, that said, you should run after it. okay. And that said, when I made this talk, I really wanted to know what will happen in this case. Like, I'll put global B, and then in bar I'll do non-local B, and let's see if the Python can compile it somehow. And of course not. It's a syntax error, no more and less. So a bit misleading. Like, I'm not sure if syntax error is the right error, but Python doesn't have a compilation error. So actually it's more compilation error than a syntax error. I mean, the syntax is correct, but it doesn't make sense in compile time. So it's a bit misleading name, but actually fun to see. So we don't have binding to B, so it doesn't work. Generator and coroutines, so they behave quite the same. Even if you suspend the coroutine or generator, it's basically the scope remains the same. There are no scope issues or anything that I found that are special about it and worth talking about. That said, the list comprehension is, again, always to the rescue with some special cases. So Python 3 also changed this. A list comprehension is like defined like a function itself. It has its own local scope. And so it won't change the I that I defined in the start of foo. That said, if anybody from any reason still uses Python 2, then why are you using Python 2? But it doesn't behave like this. So it behaves more like a loop that appends, and then the local scope is changed. I think it even will put none in I, if I remember correctly, but really I don't want to talk about Python 2. It's like so old. So, okay, so a bit of bytecode of the list comprehension. I just wanted to see, to show you that it really like behaves like an object from the this perspective. Like when you do this, like it looks like we defined a function. It has own code inside and like own variables and stuff. And I think we got to the end, but as preparing this talk, where the PEP 558 arises, and many talks in Python dev revolves around it. So there are no clear distinctions, so I didn't want to put in the talk. But things like the changing the locals will actually work in maybe the next version of Python, not 3.8, but maybe 3.9. And all semantics of the non-closed variables and locals will change. So this talk might be obsolete next year, but let's see. At least this part. So thank you.